Hello everybody, my name is Gonçalo, also known as Crash, and I'm here to talk to you about my freeware called Network Pinger. This was a piece of software, a free piece of software that I've created like 9 years ago that is very useful to do lots of stuff. For example, mass pinging like 100,000 clients at the same time, and lots of other things. It has a trace route, a port scanner, individual ping, integrated automated browsing, integrated integration with other softwares, etc. And this you can download this on networkpinger.com. Okay, you will see this page when you visit NetworkPinger. You click on enter and you'll be on this website. I'm going to explain you what is NetworkPinger and why I created NetworkPinger and how cool this piece of software is and how this piece of software has enabled my team to move from like 20 to 50 minutes work time to 1 second with this automated browsing and all this stuff that we have here. Because there was a problem when I was working as a system administrator and also network administrating, etc., in the biggest ISP company in my country. And at the time, we used Cisco routers as well as Juniper and Aries routers. And at that time, there was a problem because there was a bug on Cisco routers that made some cable modems appear not as offered or online or offline, but in this case, not as offered but as online. So we wanted to see on a CMTS, a cell of clients, how many clients were online, and our statistics would say that we had 90% of the clients online and only 10 offline. But in reality, we could have like 90% of modems stuck in offered state. They wouldn't navigate, they wouldn't have internet, etc., and 10% offline. But this way, nobody had internet. They were basically all the 100% all offline. But we thought that 90% were online due to this bug. So the only solution we had at the time was to have to do a mass pinging to all the cable modems on that cell, like 100,000 cable modems, just to see which of those were online or offline. So that was a little bit problematic because it wouldn't be as easy as I'm doing right now, just with some clicks, it would start to ping something. We didn't have that. What we had at that time was a page. We had our corporative pages. We had a page in which we could select one city. For example, imagine this was a page from our ISP company where we worked for, and imagine that here you would be able to choose, for example, a city, a region of the country. Imagine the Oporto city. We would choose it and click on X on a key, for example, and instead of appearing this. There would appear something like this, like something saying, by the way, these are examples that I've created for NetworkPinger for you to use it, to test it at home, and also for some pre-saved sessions that I've put here for you to test later. But I'm using this to explain you that we got a table like this with the IP addresses and which cell each IP address belonged to. Which PD, etc., cable modem, etc. Those who work with cable modems know what I'm talking about, okay? By the way, I would just explain that each region of the country had a CMTS, which was divided in several cities. For example, imagine each city had some cells. Each cell had several clients, and each cell had different. So you have a big region of the country, the CMTS, with several cities. Each had several cells, and inside the same cell, you could have different PDs, and the PDs were the boxes that the technicians on the field would go to visit to correct a problem physically. Okay. So and we could see the IP addresses and the MAC addresses, etc., from the cable modem. So we had tables like this. Okay. But the problem was that we have to download 100,000, for example, hosts table like this. And with all those 100,000 hosts, for example, we have to copy all this information. By the way, this will take. centuries to open because the centuries to open is a way we speak in Portugal, my country. We say a lot that something takes centuries to open, but we will take centuries to wait because 100,000 cable modems in an HTML page would occupy easily like 2 or 3 gigabytes of memory, so the computer would be very slow downloading this. So we needed to go to the website, we needed to go there to select a city from a big list of thousands of, no, not thousands, hundreds of options. We would choose the option, submit, and we would wait minutes until the HTML page would open, and then we would have to copy all these HTML, like 1 or 2 or 3 gigabytes, because although this occupies only like 20 or 30 or 50 megabytes in memory, it will occupy 2 or 3 gigabytes, so machines were very slow. We would copy all this information, okay, and we would put this, paste this on a software called Utreddit. Lots of you will know it already. And on Utreddit, we would separate these columns by chairs, okay? We would delete everything but this one with the host. We would strip the spaces, etc. Then we would copy this, and we had a piece of software, free software that would be used to do mass pinging. There were few softwares that do that. The piece of software we used usually crashed a lot, okay? And it didn't accept more than like 500 hosts. So imagine that we wanted to ping 20,000 hosts. We would have to do 40 times 500 host mass ping, then get the statistics and repeat that process like 40 times to be able to complete the 20,000 hosts mass pinging. So at the end, we needed to grab the 40 statistics, do an average, etc., just to know how many clients were up, okay? Because the piece of software didn't accept more than 500 hosts, and even with less than 500 hosts, it would crash easily. So what happened is sometimes we had 4 or 5 times those softwares open at the same time to do the mass pinging, and one of them crashed, and we had to see, hey, and what was the IP, the address that this software had that crashed? We had to search it, etc. It was terrible, 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 terrible. So we used to spend like 20 to 50 minutes just doing the bloody damn mass pinging to, for example, a 20,000 host cell of clients. It was terrible. It was terrible. So, first of all, I decided to create a piece of software which you can see here, but it wasn't like this, so pretty and so complete. At the time, I just wanted a piece of software that didn't crash, a piece of software in which I, after Utreddit, I could paste like 20,000 hosts, and it would ping those damn hosts without crashing. So I created Network Pinger. It wasn't like this initially. Initially, it just did the mass pinging. For example, I tested this with 100,000 hosts to be pinged, and it works perfectly. Also, because this has multi-threading, etc. For example, you can choose to have 200 threads and each thread pinging 100 modems. So you would have 200 threads plus times 100 modems, 2,000 hosts to be pinged at the same time. This software is very resilient, doesn't crash easily. It was very cool, and I created this software, okay, with multi-threading. Then I wanted to eliminate the Utreddit stuff to cut the columns of on Utreddit, etc. So I created systems to in which you would simply copy the table, the HTML table, and then, for example, I'm going to show you here. I would select this, copy. Then I was going to visit this, and as soon as I clicked here, it would automatically extract all the hosts from the memory. Okay, this is amazing. This is something very cool. Well, so with this, we didn't need to edit the hosts on Utreddit. Then I created an automated browsing function so that we didn't have to go to the page to wait like several minutes and minutes and minutes to wait for this to open. Because this would occupy 2 or 3 gigabytes of memory. So we didn't want to be on the page here, still hacking and waiting hours for it to construct an HTML table with thousands of votes. So what I created was an automated table. Sessions, for example, you can come here and save sessions. Okay, on save sessions, for example, this one domain names have two options, which are the two options here from the domain names. Okay, which are asking you if you want it with numbers or letters. Okay, this one, the table IP, has the other options, which are the if you want 10 or 192. These are just two examples that I've created for you. This one, as you can see, if I select one, it extracts these IPs. If I select this one, it extracts the other IPs. So what you're seeing here with this one, and not only with this one, but also with the domain name, the session, this one, is that when I choose letters, it goes to the website and extracts all the information and pings the information, etc., without me having to go to the website. And when I choose numbers, for example, it goes to the website and selects all the hosts, starts pinging them, etc., and does all the work for us. So when I created this, so as I've explained you, I've initially did a mass pinger to have something that would not crash with more than 500 volts and even less. And then I created something that would allow me to paste stuff and it would select the IP address, like with WebGL rules or something, instead of making me use UltraEdit and stuff like that. And only after that did I added the additional function of automated browsing to make it go to our own pages, select the options we wanted, etc. So if I wanted to see modems from Oporto region, I would select an already made session that would go to Oporto, for example. I would call it, for example, Oporto, and not this example. And when I open that, it would automatically fill this with all the cells that I would see on the page. Like, for example, the cells that would appear here, for example, hundreds of cells. It would fill this with hundreds of cells. I just needed to select the city. For example, let's imagine this is City Gaia. I would select it, and it would get all the hosts from that city, and it would start pinging them very quickly. So this was an amazing piece of software. With these three functions alone, the mass pinging and the paste, etc., and now the automatic browsing function, I would have this very something very fast. You can see that all the fields from the table are also here. Okay, this is very useful here. For example, I'm going to show this. This is a static HTML table. This is a standalone program. I forgot to tell you, it has only an executable file. It's a standalone, very cool program, very small. And with this,
I can tell you that, for example,
I had one for the static table. It is, where is it? An automated table. It is here.
this come with the
The pre-made samples that come with the software. You can see here that the stuff that we had there is already here also. So,
typing the clients. I could see which clients were down, which IP addresses, which MAC addresses belonged to those IP addresses to study them if necessary. And I could see, for example, which PDs were off.
I could see if the entire cell 0 is off or no. For example, the entire cell 1 is off, the cell 2, but not the cell 0. The cell 0 is okay, but we have on the cell 0 4 or 5 that don't have internet, but this one has, for example. So we could see if it was a problem from the entire city, from a single cell or several,
or inside the cell a single PD. If it was a PD,
it was a question of a technician going there to correct a problem physically. The PD could be something used on one or two or three buildings, for example. And this way we could check everything. This was very cool. This was an amazing piece of software. So we didn't have to go to pages to select cities, to select blah 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 and take care of everything. We just select the city, the region. Here we selected the city, for example, and checked which modems were down. and if the entire zone was down or not, or if it was just another type of problem, etc. To see if the bug was happening with Cisco routers that show offered modems in an online state, okay? So this was a pretty good piece of software with customized shards. This software had everything. I'm suspicious talking so well about this software because I made it myself. As they say in my country, if you want something well done, we have to do this ourselves. I'm not saying that other softwares are not as cool, but at the time I created this one, no other software would do what this does. There were only a few small softwares doing mass pinging, and they didn't have all this. So after doing the mass pinging software, I decided to do other stuff. By the way, I have filter tables here without alerts, the yellow alerts also, none is here, the red alerts.
I could define in real time what would create a yellow alert. For example, if I put here 9,
It would stop. If I put here, like for example, I could change the colors of this. So in real time, this was pretty amazing. You could go to an editor to alter, for example, the report you were going to print before printing. Then you could do a printing yourself. You had print previews. This piece of software was thought in every way, with links customized here, logo types here for the company to print. This was a very cool piece of software, and still is, in my point of view. So you had all of this, and then as I was not doing only system administrating but also networking, network administrating, etc. I used to create IP range, IP addresses lists for clients. For example, a city had too few IP addresses. I would create a new list of IP addresses for that city, etc. For that, I needed to calculate networks. So, for example, you have a slash 24 IP address, which is 256 IP addresses, but you only see 254, for example, if you get here and see.
check let's go 113 164. Okay, and
24, and you click on extract, you have 254 and not 256, because the 0 is the network IP address and the last one is the broadcast IP address. So those don't count. By the way, for those who don't know, you can put the 25. 25 has only 108, 64, here 32, here 16 IP addresses. If I extract, I will only have 16 IP addresses, okay? But we only used like very small networks, like four or two, in this case, four IP addresses, which only had two available, on static IP addresses range. So we usually worked with 24 or bigger, okay? So this is not okay. I'm going to put here like that 23, which would give us 512 IP addresses, okay? From 164.1 to 165.225, okay? 24, because the 25 will be used as a broadcast. So we had an IP calculator. I created this IP calculator for us. We had to convert IPs to long, IPs to binary, IP addresses, etc. And then I implemented some stuff, very cool stuff like this. This is very cool. I used to play with this. When you can see the subnet mask with this, okay? This is the subnet mask. You can see the net mask here, okay? The number of zeros, the number of ones. If you want to have 226 possible IP addresses, you would have to have all the 8 bits available for you. So this would have 8 zeros here. You can see this here, host 224, because the first one is the network address. The last one is the broadcast address, okay? You would have the wildcards here, etc. And something very cool. Watch this. If I put this, it would even alert me that the network IP address wouldn't correspond to the IP I have given. This was to avoid mistakes that we did sometimes, etc. I never did. Luckily, as I'm not perfect, okay? So I created a network calculator. I can create a standalone everywhere just for this calculator if you want me to. If you want, tell me on the comments and I will create this separately for you to use because this is very cool. Then, with the single pinging and also the mass pinging created with automated browsing and all the cool functionalities that these have, I created also the standalone ping because when we had, for example, mass pinging, a huge mass pinging already done, we could decide to, for example, imagine that you were seeing a report of these IP addresses and you notice that one of them was very strange, acting very strange. You would choose it, for example, like this, and this is already integrated with PuTTY, SSH, Telnet, etc., and customized commands like, for example, calculator. I don't know. Don't ask me why I have a calculator here, but well, it's for calculating IP addresses, etc. So, and I could decide to do a ping, a trace route, etc. So I needed an individual ping also. Now, imagine here, I'm not going to use it with this. I'm going to show you another cool thing that I have here with the automated IP addresses. Ah, by the way, I have this in Portuguese. I need to put it. Ah, no, it is in English. Cool. Okay, I'm going to do a single ping on my own host. Notice how it becomes a lot faster when I change this in real time. Okay, 10 milliseconds. Just 1 millisecond, it would be even faster. You can see it increasing here, but it will be a lot faster if I remove this. Notice how it is faster right now, and it would be even faster if I would turn off the shards in real time. I could change this in real time, like one here, 2 milliseconds here, for example, or zero here and one here, etc. Well, this is a pretty cool chart. And you can change this in real time. I'm going to localhost and I'm going to do this. I'm going to turn off the change all at the same time. And now I'm going to put here like some Google.com, Google.com. I said ponto because in my own language dot is set ponto. Now you are seeing this. Imagine that I'm going to shorten the time to live to only 10. It would give me a message, no, 9 to 9, expired in transit, okay? Ah, just once, because just once he had to go to a different routing. Now, 8. 8 is always expired in transit, but not 9 isn't, okay? Do you want to know why? This is pretty amazing, because this software is very good for persons to learn networking, etc. Also, I'm going to do a trace route to this IP address, and this is also a very fast trace route because it will first of all do the first testing, and only after it goes through all the hops, through all the routers, it starts to do the reverse ANS on the contrary, okay? On the reverse. So this is pretty cool piece of software because it is very fast. It gives you the trace route very fast, the trace route results, and not only at the end it will start to do the reverse DNS on the reverse way. Okay, this is pretty cool, and this explains why I'm going to show this again. It has to go through 9 hops, 9 routers until it reaches destination. So if you start pinging this with a time to live in 8, it doesn't reach the 9. If I put a 9, it already reaches destination. But if you put 8,
it won't reach the destination because it will reach the 8th router and it will give an expired in transit warning. Okay, so this piece of software not only has very cool tools, graphical tools like trace routes, etc., but it also is excellent for persons to learn how network work. And well, it is very pleasant also. It is amazing. Now, I decided to create a port scan also. I wanted to create a mass port scan for me to be able to port scan a certain range of ports in like 512 IP addresses, like if you wanted to see if our clients were infected with some strange Trojan that would open like the 500 door
a port, and we would do a mass port scan to all those clients. But then, as I will release this at for public, I remember that that would be like kind of an attack weapon, and I could be, I don't know if I could or not, be accused of doing hacking tools or something. So I didn't create that. But if someone tells me that that is if someone tells me that that is something that is acceptable, we can do that one day. We create an open source from this. But now I'm going to do a port scan on my own machine, and with this port scan I'm going to, oops, I opened it several at the same time. I created my own port scan tool, made in my own way. I'm going to test my machine. I'm using a Windows machine, so I will have some ports open that you will find here. Start port scan. Notice as it is doing the port scans here, and for each port that I have opened, it would say that the 135 port could be used for DCI endpoint resolution, Microsoft EPMAP endpoint mapper, blah 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 blah. So it would tell me everything about the ports on the machines that were opened. And this was very cool because I created a list of known ports taken, I don't remember, but I think it was from Wikipedia, with all the ports that were available. So you could see like lots of clients using, having for example, this port open. It was because lots of clients had servers from Counter-Strike, etc., for example, I don't know. So this was a pretty good piece of software. It is very good for learning purposes also. So I'm really proud of this. I've done this in 6 months, in a time that I was more motivated, and I programmed very, very fast. Nowadays I'm tired of programming, so I'm not as motivated as before. I created also something very similar, which was WMI queries. These were used for us on the server, on our all these tools were for us to administrate our servers on that ISP. I was the tool builder of my team. We had a team of 10, like 10 persons, administrating all the servers of my country, and we had also specific dedicated administrators for each machine and each stuff. We were the ones that took care of everything globally, all the problems. But when the problem took too much time, like 1 or 2 hours to solve, we would escalate that to a person that was dedicated to that server. Okay, so we were the kind of the masters of everything, and the others were specialized on certain servers. It was pretty cool. And from those 10, I was the one that was a tool builder, but I didn't like to do tools in the Microsoft Shell. I hate that. It's stupid PowerShell. So I used to do things in C++ or .NET in Windows, etc. I wanted to do this one in .NET because I wanted people to have a very cool tool for free at home that any people could use, also to teach people networking. Now I'm going to click on WMI queries, and you can see that we use this to get information for machines remotely because we wanted to know, we wanted to go to a server to install something, and we needed to know what kind of material that server had. I'm doing this on my own machine. I'm going to ask information about the cooling device classes from my machine, input device classes, and also the desktop, my desktop. Okay, let's see. And the same way I'm getting information from my own machine, we used to get information from servers remotely, Windows servers, etc. So I'm going to, okay, I have all the information here. This is my desktop. I'm going to hide some stuff here. You have here Gonçalo, etc. Administrator, my username, etc. And you can see here the stuff I use, okay? And you had also a list of all WMI classes that were known. You can see the list here, okay? You could print these, etc. So this piece of software was amazing. This was amazing. And you could also see to which, for example, Google.com. Google.com has an IP address, as you know. I could click on this IP address and reverse DNS the IP address, and I would see that it would belong to some server from Google, which would be this server, or maybe some proxy, I don't know. It depends on where I am, etc. So now, and I could do the reverse. I could, by the way, I could do something very cool. I could do a WIS from this IP address, and I will get information from RIP networks saying that this IP address was from RIP or other stuff. This wasn't, no, this wasn't from RIP in Europe. This was from IRIN to say which, where the IP address was located in the administrators from this IP address, etc. And I could do the same for domain names. I could see who was the owner of the domain name google.com. Where is a WHOIS, okay? And this was very fast, very, very fast. You can see here the who is the owner from Google, etc. And if we did this, not for Google, but for example, for some Spanish domain name, for example, it was already ready to in certain networks that wouldn't allow us to get the information automatically, it would open the page that would let us do that. So this was very complete. I had a page here. I just needed to write here the captcha, NAT5, for NAT5. So, and I would get information about this domain name in a browser that I've made, which I gave the name Navigator in memory or to the Discovery Ages from my country, Portuguese, and with the Portuguese caravel here, the drone. Well, it was very cool, this. So it did all the work for you. This was pretty cool. Reports, printing, logo types, everything. This software did everything that you wanted it to do. This was a very cool software. It would resolve, etc. Reverse NS. It had, as I told you, tools to define hosts by memory, etc. IP calculators. It had custom commands. It had integration with other pieces of other softwares. For example, here you can see customize remote connections. Okay, you could customize telnet, rlogin, rlogin, raw, etc. So this was pretty amazing. So you could add other types of connections to other softwares instead of Qt. Define the number of threads, the yellow alerts by default, the logo types, etc. This was a very, very complete piece of software. And it had always also the translation to other languages, traditional Chinese, the new Chinese, the Chinese Mandarin, of course, the Russian here, etc. I translated to all languages, but I'm only fluent in English and Portuguese and Spanish, etc. Although I don't speak English for ages, so my English is a little bit racial now because I never speak English to anyone. But I can speak it very well also because I think very fast. I have lots of easiness in lots of things. You might think that I'm speaking English very fast because I have lots of training. I don't have any training for years in English. If I had training, I would be speaking a lot faster. I just speak fast because I think fast. That's only the reason that it seems that I'm speaking English very fast. It's not because I have lots of training, because I don't speak English for years, literally. I only write English. I'm just speaking fast because I can speak fast any language, like for example, ich muss da gar nicht versetzen. Gibt es da gar nicht versetzen zu denken? Oh, ich muss da gar nicht versetzen. Gibt es da gar nicht versetzen können? Gehen Sie geradeaus. Ich brauche etwas gegen Kopfschmerzen. This is Germany, German, but I could say, ich brauche etwas gegen Kopfschmerzen, with an accent, German accent. But if I speak it very fast, my accent is gone, okay? So I can speak languages very fast, like for example, no, je ne parle pas français, with accent, etc. But it doesn't mean that I have practice. I don't speak English for ages. But I translated it well for English, Spanish, Portuguese, because I'm Portuguese, I speak Portuguese. It would be terrible if I was a Portuguese and didn't speak Portuguese, French, etc. Well, this is a pretty cool piece of software. This software has some networks inside, which are the translating databases, the list of known ports for port scans, the WMI queries, etc. Now, I'm thinking in someday making this an open source project so that other persons, because I don't have patience nowadays, lots of programs get together and make this an even better piece of free software that allows us any person to graphically do very easily, do all kinds of tests like trace routes, pings, mass pings, and even mass port scans if we want one day. This could be a very cool piece of software ported to Macintosh, to Mac, so for example, to Linux, especially in Linux, and not only Windows, etc. So if you want to participate in this one day, tell me something. Tell me, if you don't, tell me what features you want to see added here. But anyway, I can tell you that a lot of persons have used this. You have a website talking about this. The website was, I started to translate this website, but I got tired and I gave up. But a big part of it is translated in the FAQ. The other you can translate with Google Translator. I can tell you that I've cut the guest book commentaries in 2013 because of some bugs. Someone was already asking me to review the third source to make an open source. It was full. I must do it one day. By the way, this Todd Goodyear was one of the administrators of Bank of America. He was the CTO administrator from the technical team, and he used this piece of software to ping lots of machines to see how their networks were doing, or their groups of thousands of computers, if they were up or down, to see the response times, if the network was slow or not. This piece of software is pretty cool. This piece of software is only on the first year was published on the biggest IT magazine from Denmark and also from the biggest IT magazine from Germany. So this piece of software is pretty cool. It has received some prizes, etc. And I just was attentive on the first year. Then I didn't care more about this. I don't know if it was published on other stuff or not. But this software is pretty cool. It has lots of features, as I've shown you, and it is really pretty cool. It is very fast. It can do like thousands of pings per second. It is pretty cool. Maybe one day, if you want to help me develop it, we can make it create theme code. No. Although I've done some bad things in the past between maximum 2004, I don't want this to be a hacking tool. But I wanted to say you could it would be cool to create a standardized packet, no, customized packets like with sync flags, etc. To test network tests, etc. But anyway, it has lots of stuff, graphics. Don't mind. Lots of stuff, customized programs, sessions, saved sessions, real-time charts, creation and printing of reports, updates, free. It is free. This is a very cool piece of software. So if any of you likes this and wants to make this an even better piece of software, tell me something that we can create a work group to make this an even better piece of software. And I could search a code because this one is obfuscated. Don't ask me why. I was a little bit paranoid at the time. This one is
Can search the code, create an open source listing for this software. We can put this software updated because this was on the framework .NET framework 3.5. We can update this. We can port this to Linux, to Mac, etc. So if you want to help me and be part of open source project, tell me something and we can
make this even better and give an even better tool to all the public as open source, okay? If you want to participate, tell me something. And by the way, I hope you have enjoyed this. I basically created this because I wanted to
make a 20-minute
to 15-minute work into something that could be done in 1 second.
and it was. I transformed this from 20 minutes to 1 second because we just needed a double click and it would do everything that we wanted. It was pretty cool. And I created this and I was going to okay. At the time we stopped using this because this was working well. So we gave permissions to other seconds on that ISP
to be able to ping the private
cable modem IP addresses and not only the public. So that they could do the test also, because of that SysProtter bug, okay? So at that time, they used this, but it reached a point that they have to stop using this, because if 100 clients would say that they were down, they couldn't be pinging 100 times, like 100,000 clients for each cell, etc., just to know if it was okay or not. So it wasn't practical. So this worked on the ISP until they created some scripts to do some pinging to the entire cells from a certain amount of minutes, okay? And this time, when clients phoned them, they would only check those reports and see that like 3 minutes ago, 90% of the clients were up or down due to those mass pinging that they would do on a single server. And this way, we wouldn't have some cells being pinged hundreds of times per day, but instead like 3 or 4 times per day, okay? This was a lot better than before. So all these systems that are pinging now, that ISP that ISP in my country for which I work for, that are nowadays pinging like from 10 to 10 minutes each cable modem on each network, this all started with this piece of software that was doing this, and at a time each person was pinging the entire cell until they created that solution, okay, due to a Cisco router's bug that would show offered modems as online. This is just history of network pinger that changed the way of working of the biggest ISP company in Portuguese in which I worked for, and that was as thousands of downloads per month. It is very used nowadays, and it was used in other companies like Bank of America, as I told you. So this is a pretty cool piece of software. So if you like this video, please comment the video, tell me what you think about this software. Do a like on this video, share this video, subscribe my channel to be attentive to all kinds of stuff that I do, like retro gaming, etc. And I want to tell you one thing. Look at this software. Look how pretty this is, and you will see that this piece of software, I did this piece of software with love because it is really, really pretty. As you can see, the Portuguese card overview here, etc. The shards gave me some trouble to make this work. This is a pretty cool piece of software, and I think it deserves to be continued. So if you want to help me as a computer programmer to participate, to make this an open source project, and make this a tool that is developed by thousands of computer programmers everywhere, to make this the best tool ever for sysadmins and network admins. So please tell me something, and we can make this an open source project for all of us, okay? But if you don't, please subscribe my channel, do a like, put a like on this video, share it among your friends, especially sys and network admins, and comment what you think about it, okay? Thank you for watching this video, and have a nice day. See you on my next video. Goodbye. Ah, by the way, I have other softwares, okay, like Emailer Plus, etc. And systems that invest alone, trading systems, etc. Well, see you. Goodbye.